So the sixth round of NAFTA negotiations have just wrapped up in Montreal, and we've been hearing all kinds of rumors that perhaps these talks will extend into 2019. There's talk that Trump might extend that deadline past March. Our foreign affairs minister said there was a significant gap. You were there, and I'm curious to know, what are the prospects of a deal? What did you hear?
Poor at best. The United States has far too many poison pills on the table. They have proposals that are just so outrageous that it's really a non-starter. So the only way that NAFTA will conclude is if the United States dramatically alters their position that they've taken right from the beginning, and I don't think that they're gonna do that. NAFTA negotiation so far has been about politics. It has nothing to do with economics. So when the United States takes positions such as in the auto industry, for the example, 50% of all vehicles, whether or not it's cars, trucks, light vehicles, tractors, anything on four wheels, anything that's sold into the United States has to have 50% U.S. content. Well, that means that the companies will err on the side of caution, so it'll be closer to 60%, 65%, and that leaves Canada and Mexico wrestling for the remaining 35 or 40%. And based on the fact that Mexican workers are living in poverty, facts are 50% of all Mexico is still in poverty, minimum wage is 65 cents an hour, the chances of Canada grabbing a lion's share of that 35 to 40% that'll be left is non-existent. So for Canada to sign anything like that means the death of our auto industry, which is an $80 billion a year industry. It's our number one export industry in the country. So that's one example of the foolish proposals, and there are numerous foolish proposals on the table that are non-starters. So will Donald Trump completely capitulate? The answer is no. That's why I know NAFTA is going nowhere.
In his State of the Union address, he glazed over NAFTA. He simply said that trade needs to be reciprocal. And I'm wondering if and when the president does tweet something while we're in the midst of these negotiations, how responsive are U.S. trade representatives? I mean, do they react immediately? Do they not even take that into consideration, what the U.S. president tweets?
No, they're marching to the orders. There's no question about it. Trump is the one that's laying out the country's positions. The contentious issues are his. So it's not as if you have people who are here representing the United States that have their own agenda. There's no question. They are there because of the president's agenda. Now, when Trump says that NAFTA has been a colossal disaster for the United States, I agree. It's the only thing in this world, by the way, I agree with Donald Trump on, is the negative impact that NAFTA has had on working class people. If I just take a look at the auto industry, we've closed 4 auto assembly plants in Canada. They've closed 10 in the United States. They've opened 8 in Mexico. They're opening 2 more in Mexico. BMW is opening a plant in 2019 where the workers are going to make $1.10 an hour. So there's been a straight exodus of jobs, good manufacturing jobs, from Canada to the United States to Mexico. The Mexicans got the jobs, but they never got the compensation, so they've been completely exploited. So workers in all 3 countries have really been the loser from NAFTA. So when he says that it's been a colossal disaster, I agree with him.
On the Unifor website, I think it states that less than 4% of a car is labor. Are they focusing on the wrong thing? Like, as opposed to focusing on rules of origin, should we be having conversations about wage standards?
Yes.
In Mexico.
Yes, and we are talking about it. The preoccupation with rules of origin is interesting because that in itself fixes nothing. And let me give you an example. The reason that Trump will talk about an 85% rules of origin is really to wrestle back a lot of the auto parts jobs from Europe and Asia and to setting up more factories in the North American market, which makes a lot of sense to me. 85 might be pushing it, but the philosophy behind raising the rules of origin, I totally agree with. But unless you fix the Mexican labor standards, the factories will come to North America, all right, but they'll all go to Mexico. So rules of origin in itself is only one small piece of it. We need to deal with the serious issue, and the serious issue is the labor standards in Mexico. We can't compete with $2, $3, and $4 an hour in the auto industry. A Mexican worker in an auto factory can never afford to buy the car that they build. Canada right now builds about 2 million vehicles a year. Mexico builds over 4 million vehicles a year and are heading to 5 million. So it's clear where the jobs are going. People say, oh, geez, the jobs have all been lost as a result of technology. No, they haven't. Some jobs have, for sure. But we sold 18 million vehicles in the North American market last year. So the market is as strong as it ever has been. The question is, who's building the cars? And those cars aren't being built anymore in Canada, the United States. All of the investments are going to Mexico.
Should we have signed TPP given that we are in the midst of negotiating NAFTA?
Foolish move. That is, I will argue, the most foolish decision that this federal Liberal government has done.
But we have to diversify trade. I mean, we can't just focus solely on North America.
No argument.
This gives us the opportunity.
No, but hold on here. 85% of all of our trade in Canada is in the NAFTA region. It's 24% of the world's GDP. So why you would undermine what you're doing in NAFTA by signing a TPP makes absolutely no sense. And let me give you an example, or give you two examples. Here in NAFTA, we're talking about increasing the rules of origin. By signing TPP, we just lowered dramatically the rules of origin. So now you have the entire industry here in Canada furious. Ford's furious, GM's furious, Chrysler is furious, Magna, Martin Rea, the major auto parts companies are yelling and screaming at the Trudeau government for undermining them. Who's celebrating? Honda and Toyota. Why? Because it is now cheaper for them to build a car in Japan with non-TPP parts, predominantly from China for the purpose of the discussion. It's cheaper for them to build it there and ship it to the North American market. So we just undermined our auto industry again. So this is about consistency. You can't talk about increasing the rules of origin in NAFTA and just dramatically reduce them in a TPP. It shows that you don't have any idea of what you're doing. It shows that the positions you're taking are flexible based on who speaks to you last. So the rules of origin piece is one thing. Now, they sign a TPP deal where they recognize and agree that there will be no free collective bargaining in Vietnam for 5 years. And then they agreed on language for labor that completely undermines what it is we're trying to do with NAFTA. So here you've got one table in Montreal where we're saying labor standards are critical. We got to fix the Mexican mess as it relates in order for us to compete. We need to make sure that we stabilize our auto industry. And then we sign a TPP deal that undermines the auto industry and says we don't care about labor standards. So you've got a government in Ottawa that takes one position here and another position here. So we talk about Donald Trump being unpredictable. Well, based on signing the TPP, so are we. So this isn't about trade, because listen, nobody understands the importance of trade more than I do. 85% of everything my members manufacture are exported. So nobody understands the importance of trade deals better than I do. But you have, trade is about me selling you something and you selling me something. It's about back and forth. That's not what's happening with the TPP. That's certainly not what happened with Korea. And this was a golden opportunity, because if you fix NAFTA, that becomes the template for the rest of the world. And I'll argue we just blew it.